away.
Okay, let's just jump right into it.
He just came here from Atlanta. He was checking into the hotel. And there was a certain joy there because we were really kind of rolling.
I hadn't seen him that jovial and clowning and free in a long time. He was in a very playful mood. One of the reporters said, "Now, Andy, I know you don't like us getting in your face with the camera, but I got to keep a camera on Dr. King, because if he gets shot and I don't get a picture of it, I lose my job." Martin thought that was funny. And he said, "Now, I tell you what's going to happen. They might take a shot at me, but one of you all will be jumping in front and take it for me." Somebody knocked on the door and said, "You're supposed to be at dinner at 6 o'clock. You all need to get rest."
Jesse Jackson and some others are downstairs. Martin's on the balcony, they're downstairs. And Martin yells out to Jesse, "Jesse, time to go to dinner, man. Put your suit on."
And I said, "Dr. King, a prerequisite for eating is not a tie, but an appetite." He said, "You're crazy." And we laughed. Doc, doc, pow. He was dead on the impact. The whole world changed. It shook the world. It shook the world.
If I can help.
Every day I miss my friend. My teacher, my pastor, my mentor, my conscience.
Once I saw that the shot hit home and I realized he was going home, I was worried about how we keep going. Because the one thing we couldn't do was let a bullet stop the movement.
Then my living.
Okay, and so we're going to look at what happens with the assassination of Dr. King. And again, I want to highlight my theory, and it's again, you have to take it within the context of what I've presented about the whole of history, and that is that once we became people of property, of excess, of wealth and power, that became the reason for human existence. Not for everyone, but for a select few who wanted to dominate, who were filled with greed, and there was no moral constraint on them. And as we look at the events in history, we find that time and time again, things that most people would not do, these people would do. They would invade lands and kill everybody who was there. We've talked about that happening in the West Indies. We can also go to Australia, New Zealand, Tasmania, and other places and look at entire populations wiped out, all in service of greed and feeding the empire and the emperor and the kings and the queens. And so I've talked about how race became a mechanism for rationalizing and justifying the activities for greed. And when I talk about bigotry, I've tried to say to you, it's not just about Black people. Bigotry takes in everyone. Bigotry applies to Black people, applies to short white people, it applies to homosexuals, it applies to people of all different faiths. What you can use bigotry to get people to be frightened of other people. And once they're frightened, you can then generate hate. And that hate then becomes a tool, a political tool, to rationalize and justify my horrible behavior. And Martin Luther King, people can talk about, you know, all of his personal characteristics and all of that. It doesn't matter. It doesn't matter. It doesn't matter if he was white or he was black or he was Jewish, whatever. He had that ability to drive right into the heart of it all. And he posed a threat to bigotry. And if you're going to take away that tool of bigotry, how am I going to run a political campaign? If you don't think there's bigotry, turn on any of the political campaigns. I mean, the theme is back there in so many of the races going on in America and around the world. So it's imperative that we recognize it, that we understand it, and that it's not just about the murder of one person and the events. We got to capture the bad guy who did this. This was horrible. Yes, it was horrible, but there's more at play. There's a much bigger
exclusive corporate
global event that's taking place, and we need to understand what that is.
Offered the Sloan Foundation.
Give me a second while I get our next one.
Thank you.
My family constantly moved. They were constantly changing their name to elude the law. Really sordid and sad family history.
That created an incredible craving. It created a craving for being somebody. I think at the heart of James Earl Ray is just the desire to say, somebody look at me. Somebody know I exist.
On March 16th, Martin Luther King comes to Los Angeles to give a series of talks. And at one point, he's only a few miles away from where Ray is staying. And it's at that point that it becomes clear that Ray is focusing. Perhaps it was something that King said that was repeated on the television news or something in the newspaper. Something set him off. But the very next day, Ray goes to the post office and has his mail forwarded general delivery, Atlanta, Georgia. And he takes off east towards Atlanta. He has no connection to Atlanta. He's going to live there, Martin Luther King's hometown.
This is Ray Sherman, United Press International in Memphis. 1,000 striking sanitation workers marched on Memphis City Hall this afternoon and demanded Mayor Henry Loeb hear their grievances.
We've been talking about the garbage strike. Whether you realize it or not, we also have a racial issue. How do you expect to handle the racial issue in Memphis now?
Well, let me ask you this way.
The garbage collectors, predominantly Negro, want higher pay and union recognition.
We hope and pray that this city of ours, which we love dearly, will listen to the effort that we have been making for justice for the sanitation workers and for hope for poor people and for black people.
Martin had a real sensitivity to poor people's plight. And he was torn in this. He used to say, I admire the Good Samaritan, but I don't want to be one. I don't want to spend my time picking up people by the side of the road after they've been robbed and beaten up. I want to change the Jericho Road. So we were saying to him, look, we're in the process of changing the Jericho Road. You can't stop and pick up every little group along the way if you're going to change the road, see? And he said, yeah, but I can't say no to these garbage workers.
It began with a tragedy. On a cold day in Memphis, these garbage workers, some of them got up in the truck. they had these compression trucks where you put the garbage in and then you flip the switch and it would compress the garbage.
There was a malfunctioning truck. These two men were trying to get out of the rain, got in the truck, and the truck compacted them and killed them in that garbage.
It turned out that the families did not have enough money to bury them. It brought up a real tragedy how little these men were paid.
We was making about 75, 80 cents, maybe not that much, an hour. And that wasn't enough to feed my family. We didn't have nowhere to shower. We didn't have no showers. And it was rough. You had to go home looking like that. Maggots be in my shoes, all over my pants. You couldn't catch the bus, so you had to walk home. Sometimes I'd get on the bus, I'd get rid of the back. People said, them over there, it's the garbage man. So I stopped riding the bus and I started walking.
They had tried for years to get better wages. They'd been to the ministers. We had tried and had never succeeded. And finally, it blew up.
Public employees cannot strike against their employer. And this
Henry Loeb, who was the mayor, asked for a meeting with the workers.
It's certainly right that you should come to your mayor and bring up anything you want. You can ask me any question.
And Henry got up, and Henry thought that, you know, in sort of a paternalistic manner, he would say, now, come on, fellas, you know, you can't strike. It's against the law. And he thought that they would just fall in step because, you know, Massa was saying, you need to stop this foolishness.
I hate to interrupt, but I want to highlight when I said that the system that emerged in the cotton plantation South, it really from the inception of America, that there became a system and people got taught that system and wages and everything about where you put money and all of that. Everybody learned to do the same thing. So we get to the Civil War and the Civil War is over, but the system doesn't change. The system remains the same. And so when we get to this point, what's the mayor saying? Wait a second, we got a system. You can't strike. It's against the law. The slave institution continued and probably is continuing today.
I suggest that you go back to work.
A lot of the men was uneducated, but they know when somebody was making a fool out of them. And they stood up and refused to take anything. We took all we could take, and we wasn't gonna take no more.
And the city was surprised that all of them joined in the strike. I don't think there were 10 who stayed on the job.
They say, if you go on a strike, you're gonna get fired. And plenty of people were scared. I was scared though, but I signed up. He said, I'm gonna get fired. I said, I'm gonna get fired. I just get fired, that's all. It was nothing but signs. Plenty of signs. The babies, the ladies, everybody had a sign. Had that big sign, say, I'm a man. Cause they didn't treat us as a man. They didn't treat us like we just nobody.
They were not asking for the moon. They just wanted decent conditions and the money that they were supposed to make. And it was totally compelling to see these men having to assert, I am a man. I should be treated as a human being, as a man, dignity, respect. You couldn't not be moved.
That caught Dr. King. Here these men, ignored, spat on, lied on, working 40, 50 hours a week and still having to get food stamps to live. And Dr. King saw it, and he felt that if I'm ever going to help anybody, I ought to help these people.
The staff said, we can't do it.
He overruled the Serbs, so yeah, we're going. They said, we're behind on the Poor People's Campaign. He says, no, we're going to Memphis. That's it.
What was happening in Memphis really lured him in. It was the perfect expression of what he was trying to do in Washington. And King realizes instead of taking a right turn to Washington, he first had to make this left turn into Memphis. He couldn't ignore the call of these striking garbage workers.
On March 22nd, Ray is driving from Los Angeles to Atlanta, King's hometown, where King should show up. So he's on the trail. He's following King.
Ray goes to Atlanta and checks into one of his typical flop houses in a slightly decrepit hippie district off Peachtree Street. And he begins to plan. He buys a map of Atlanta and he circles the map. King's church, where King's house is.
And he plots out where King's world is, where he stays, where he works. Obviously, he's focused now on King.
Assassins turn out to be often people in their early 20s. They're 22, 23, they're Oswald's age, 24. They're imbued with the idea that they have found the right answer to the world, and they can change the world with a gun and a bullet. Very seldom are assassins Ray's age, 40. People at Ray's age have lost the fervor. So it's a very unusual thing.
I think you could say that the idea of killing King was a solution to all of his problems. It gave him focus. It gave him something to plan and to plot for. It fit in with his own resentments and ideas about the direction that America was heading in. And I think finally, he began to see this as his opportunity to do something huge.
Today in Memphis, a 3,000-man protest march led by Dr. Martin Luther King Jr. in support of a 7-week-old city sanitation workers' strike. Strike has turned into a major racial issue in Memphis.
So when he came to Memphis, you seen people lining up. Memphis lining up. Dr. King coming. Dr. King coming. They're shouting, Dr. King coming. Dr. King coming. That's all they heard. Real nice.
Ain't gonna let nobody turn me around, turn me around, turn me around. Ain't gonna let nobody turn me around. Keep on walking, keep on talking, walking up the freedom land.
Ain't gonna let nobody, baby, turn me around, turn me around, turn me around. Ain't gonna let nobody, baby, turn me around. Keep on walking, yeah, keep on.
We felt brave, and we felt like God had sent somebody to brought us out of the land of Egypt into promised land.
When he got there, the crowd had been gathering there for a long time and were restless.
I was around at the back of the march because I always wanted to give some leadership in the back. And I could hear on the policeman's, I heard this noise. And the police radio kept saying, permission to break up the march. Permission to break up the march.
Group of wild young men broke some glass windows. And when they exploded, the police exploded on them.
Permission to break up the march. The Negroes are rioting. The Negroes are rioting. And finally I heard on his radio, permission granted. And that's when they just waded into the crowd.
Get out of here! Them police was whooping, dogs barking. I was hit me all the side of my head. It was just like a war zone.
People started running in all directions, and police were macing people.
Cops came from everywhere, beating heads, swinging their clubs. Police department had gone crazy. And we knew immediately we had to get Martin out of that.
He was being ridiculed for leaving, and he decided he had to go back and resume the struggle. Memphis became a great test of whether nonviolence could work in a situation where violence was prevailing.
I talked to him after the march dissolved into violence. And then everybody started talking about King has passed it, he's lost it, he doesn't have blah, 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 blah. I said, I wouldn't go there again if I were you. I just wouldn't do it. And he said, I'm going to do it. And I said, why are you going to do it? Why are you going to do it? He said, because I promised them. Because I promised them.
I want to just stop there for a second. I want to highlight that, and the colonel is on in this class, and he's heard me say this way too many times. But there are multiple levels to investigations. There's the immediate crime that has taken place, and you need to investigate that, gather the evidence, all the minutia about that micro event. But then there's another level, a more broader picture macro event. And it often is lost. Often, like all of the time, it's lost because we just get focused on, if we get the bad guy, we got him. We got the guy who killed King, we got him. But there's a bigger thing going on here. Here is this 40-year-old escaped prisoner who is going to be politically infused with ideas that he's got to save the country, and to do it, he has to go kill Martin Luther King. People in prison don't have that kind of thing. They don't, you know, they're not. and so there's no patriotism or any of that nonsense. It is this 44-year-old guy who's been in and out of prison his entire life. Suddenly now he's going to take it on himself to do something for a political cause, to kill him. And he's in his 40s. No. And then he's going to travel across the country. And after he shoots, he's going to fly off to foreign countries with the goal of getting to Rhodesia. Where do you get all the money to do that? He's an escaped prisoner. He's on the lam. Anyway, we're going to follow what happens because the investigation is going to do that. But I want you to have in mind that there's something bigger behind this.
If anybody is to be hurt or
killed. What's going on in King's life? He is very aware King is embroiled in a battle in Memphis. They announced the specific date that King would be returning to Memphis. And it gave Ray a little bit of time to react. So Ray goes to Birmingham and buys a rifle under the name Harvey Lohmeyer.
Ray was in the Army. He joins at 17.
He's not a natural soldier by any means. He chafes at any kind of authority.
He's drunk, he's AWOL, but the Army does teach him how to shoot well.
Well, he buys a Remington Game Master 30-06 rifle with a scope. 30-06 was the standard military round. Every time you fired it, you pumped the the fore end, and the shell would eject and another shell would load, and had a little clip that fit into the bottom and held about 5 shots.
It's a great killing rifle. It's much better than the cheap rifle that Oswald used to kill Kennedy. It's a good killing machine. 30-06 is a good slug, and I don't mean that in a cavalier way. It was a good assassin's weapon.
This is the first time that his idea of killing King has gone from the abstract to something very, very tangible. He's holding this rifle and he's realizing that he's gonna go through with this.
As far as we know, Ray has never killed anyone. We don't think he's ever shot anybody before. He's a criminal, he's a sociopath. We know that, but he is not an easy character to pigeonhole. He's not a firebrand who's out there at the forefront of racial politics or racial hatred. What was clear is this: he buys the gun in Alabama. From the 29th on, he can kill King at any point. It's just a question of opportunity.
Just a question of opportunity. Now, mind you, King has never, I'm sorry, James Earl Ray has never killed someone before. He's never killed someone before. Mind you, in the military environment, we have to make a concerted effort in training to get people to be willing to kill another human being, because it doesn't come naturally. And there's study after study after study of people in combat with an inability to shoot the person who's shooting at them. But James Earl Ray, he's in his 40s now, been involved in crime. He's at the burnout period of that. What happens? People get into their 40s, they burn out, and they kind of don't want to go. They don't change, they just burn out on it. So, but James Earl Ray is going to be infused with this spirit, and he's going to kill someone for the first time, and he's going to do it with a single bullet.
Off and check the plane for explosives or whatever. They brought dogs, I think, and they checked and they found no bomb. But why was the word out that Dr. King was going to be on that flight that morning?
Martin kind of laughed about that. He had grown accustomed to living under the threat of death. And he said, nobody can decide when and how they're going to die. They can decide, though, to keep themselves in a position so that they die for something worthwhile.
He didn't think it made any sense to be scared all the time, and he wasn't. He would not let any of his staff that traveled with him carry a pistol or a rifle or a blackjack. He did not want anybody to have any weapon of a force of retaliation, because it violated his principle of nonviolence. That was his way of life. Not a theory, but a way of life.
What have your aides told you about the cooperation that has been arranged with the young people?
Well, they've been talking with various groups, and I've gotten some very encouraging reports from them. They have talked with these groups, and these groups have committed themselves to cooperation and committed themselves to following the guidelines set forth of nonviolence and what have you.
King knew that he had to redeem himself and his reputation. This was sort of like a dress rehearsal for the Poor People's Campaign. He knew that he had to make this thing work.
Thank you very much.
Now, James Earl Ray has purchased a weapon in Birmingham. And he has a weapon for a little while. Then he decides, you know, I think I got the wrong weapon. So he brings it back and he exchanges it. This is a criminal who's now going to perpetrate a crime of murder with a weapon. Any criminal would know, I don't want to do this in a way where they can track me down, where they can, you know, get to me. So you try to do this stuff as, you know, remotely and quietly where there can't be a trick, but not James Earl Ray. No. I'm going to bring it back and exchange it. So I make sure the person who sold me the weapon will remember who I was and be able to describe it. That makes a lot of sense. Then he has this weapon. He's not fired it. But on his way, he decides, maybe I ought to test fire this thing first.
Somewhere along the way to Memphis, Ray gets out of his Mustang, a place where there's no cars or houses. What's interesting about Ray at this point, he's reading all these books and he's gravitating towards these extreme ideologies. There's one book in particular, it's called Psycho-Cybernetics. The book repeatedly says that the most important thing that we can do for our own happiness is to have a goal, a target to shoot for, as it says repeatedly. Somewhere in the book, the author quotes Emerson, "Do the thing and you will have the power."
This guy is a lifetime loser. He had loser written right across his forehead. But the way he could live in infamy was to take out someone as high and mighty and well-regarded as Martin Luther King.
He thinks he will be a hero, that the man who killed Martin Luther King would really be viewed as a hero.
I think he believes that murdering Martin Luther King is going to help Wallace. I'm convinced that's what he thought Wallace wanted, and the Wallace movement wanted.
I think he actually thought he was in the same mindset as of most white Americans. It's the last spasm of the segregated society. Ray looked at himself as basically trying to preserve what was left of that.
In Memphis, the city awaits the arrival of Dr. Martin Luther King, either early tonight or tomorrow, for the aim of holding a massive nonviolent demonstration in support of the 8-week-old strike by city sanitation workers.
Ray checks into a motel called the New Rebel, which is kind of on the outskirts of town. He checked in as Eric S. Gall.
He was up late that night, the lights were on, the clerk at the motel had seen that. King was number one news on the local news channels. 10 p.m. and 11 p.m. broadcast, both had news about King. Ray was eating it up. He's trying to figure out whether he's going to get a chance to kill King.
It rained and stormed so hard that night. And Dr. King was a featured speaker at the temple. And he had decided that there would not be many people there. He simply would not go. And he sent Abernathy to speak for him.
We got to the church. It was nearly full, in spite of the weather. Abernathy walked in. I walked in. Jesse Jackson walked in. And the people started clapping. And Abernathy's preacher sense, sir, "These people ain't clapping for us. They think Martin coming in behind us." So he went to the phone, called Martin at the motel. He said, "Man, you should get over here. These people have come in the weather to hear you." Martin said, "If you think I need to come, I'll come." So he came.
Wind was blowing, rain was hitting that roof. Pitter-patter-patter, lightning flashing ominously, thunder. Yeah, I was frightened, to tell you the truth about it. I was sitting there shaking.
The shutters in the back of the church kept banging. The wind was so high. And every time they would bang, Martin would jump like that. And they would bang, and he would jump. Bang! And I noticed that. It was really disturbing him. He was simply waiting to be introduced. And when Martin got up, he just started speaking from his heart.
The question is not if I stop to help this man in need, what will happen to me? The question is, if I do not stop to help the sanitation workers, what will happen to them? That's the question.
He talked about the time he was autographing books in New York. A demented black woman, she reached over the table and plunged a letter opener into his chest. And when he was recovering, he said he got greetings from a teenage girl who wrote, "Dear Dr. King, I read about your misfortune." The New York Times said, "The blade of the letter opener was so close to your aorta that if you had sneezed, you would have drowned in your own blood." And she put at the bottom, "I'm so glad you didn't sneeze." And he picked up on that and did a whole litany. "And I'm glad I didn't sneeze.
If I had sneezed, I wouldn't have been here in 1963. Black people of Birmingham, Alabama, aroused the conscience of this nation."
He just went on about what he would have missed had he sneezed.
I was there the night that he made that speech. He was more powerful that night. He been powerful all the time now, but there was an unusual power that he had. He really spoke so deep down out of his heart. Look like he pulled everything out of his heart.
And then I got into Memphis, and some began to talk about the threats that were out. Yeah. What would happen to me from some of our sick white brother. Well, I don't know what will happen now. We've got some difficult days ahead. But it really doesn't matter with me now, because I've been to the mountaintop. I don't mind. Like anybody, I would like to live a long life. Longevity has its place. But I'm not concerned about that now. I just want to do God's will. And he's allowed me to go up to the mountain. And I've looked over. And I've seen the promised land. I may not get there with you, but I want you to know tonight that we as a people will get to the promised land. So I'm happy tonight. I'm not worried about anything. I'm not fearing any man. Mine eyes have seen the glory of the coming of the Lord.
After that speech, he was like a kid. I mean, it was like, I'm laying this heavy burden down. I'm just laying it down. Wherever it leads me, that's where I'm going.
On the morning of the 4th, Ray found King in Memphis through public information. All he had to do was open up the newspaper. King was front page news.
The newspapers in Memphis and the television shows in Memphis showed that he was staying at the Lorraine Motel, and they even showed the room number, 306. Ray checks out of the New Rebel Motel and goes downtown and starts scoping out the Lorraine area. And he finds a rooming house that backs up to the Lorraine Motel. He checks into this rooming house. Is John Willard.
He rents the room 5B, goes to a local hardware store, and buys a pair of binoculars. So he clearly is looking at monitoring King. He can lean out the window a little bit, not very comfortable to take a shot, but with the binoculars, he can keep track on the hotel. But if he goes to the bathroom, he has a direct view of where King's room is. Ray has no idea whether he'll get a shot at King, but he's got his rifle with him.
if King comes onto the balcony and spends any time there, what Ray knows he has to do is grab that rifle, go into the bathroom and hope no one's there, lock that door, and try to take the shot.
That night, dinner was to be served at my home. And so I went to the motel to get him about 6:15. I said, guys, we gotta go. So Martin and I walked on the balcony. He stood here, and I stood here.
Ray gets these binoculars. He starts looking towards the Lorraine, and there's Martin Luther King, right there on the balcony.
He has the chance right there. He's only bought the gun 5 days earlier. He doesn't have to stalk him for the next month. This could be it. Now he has to take that rifle, get into the bathroom down the hallway, have nobody see him, get into the tub, which he has to do, and set up to take the shot and hope that when he does that, King hasn't left.
He was greeting people down in the courtyard. So Jesse Jackson, he said, Jesse, you're not dressed for dinner. Jesse said, I don't need a shirt and tie, Doc. I got an appetite. That's all I need. He said, oh, man, you crazy.
Ray goes down the hallway. Nobody sees him. He gets into the tub. King is still there. Ray sets up his 30-06, and the window ledge becomes the brace that gives him the sturdiness that he needs on a rifle. He doesn't have to hold this up in the air.
So I turn to go to the stairs to go down, and Martin was leaning over the balcony on the railing, talking to Jesse and Ben.
Ray looks through the 7-power scope and King becomes large. Most of the scope would be taken up with King's face at that point. You couldn't get a better shot, a deadly shot.
It never occurred to me that it was a bullet until I looked up and didn't see him. And I ran up the stairs and there saw him laying down in a pool of blood. And I knew then immediately it was all over.
There was so much blood. Blood was everywhere. He never spoke a word.
We have information King has been shot at the Lorraine. We have information that King has been shot at the Lorraine.
After the shot was fired, Ray knew that he would have to make a fast getaway. So he had made a bundle that he'd take with him. The rifle, his binoculars, everything else. The adrenaline has to be absolutely pounding because now it's time to escape. Ray would have to get to his car. Nobody's seeing him. And he gets outside and he turns left to go to his car. Half a block away are two police cars. And Ray couldn't tell if somebody is in the police car or if the cars are empty. Ray has to make an immediate decision. If he is caught with the murder weapon, game's over. That's it. Might as well give it up. He's the assassin. If he's caught without the weapon, he might be able to talk himself out of the reason that he's there. He decides to dump it. He dumps it into the recessed doorway next door to the flop house, and then goes to the Mustang and drives away.
There's a weapon in front of 424, and the subject ran south on Main Street.
Okay, and so before we get to this next clip, you need, as he is fleeing Memphis, right? Police pursuit of the white Mustang was thwarted by a CB radio transmission, which described a high-speed chase between the occupants of a blue Pontiac and the white Mustang. The white Mustang being the vehicle that Ray is allegedly fleeing. And even describing gunplay between the vehicles. These broadcasts appear to have been a hoax or a diversion. The broadcaster of these CB radio transmissions has never been identified.
The history of the American people giving way to their prejudices, their ignorance. I don't think Americans should mourn Martin Luther King. I think they should mourn themselves.
You have the riots at first. You have tremendous violence that this triggered. You have a movement that basically now doesn't have a leader. How are they going to react? You have the government now that's worried about, is this going to continue to spiral out of control? How are we going to give people confidence that we're going to be able to get the right person and bring him to justice, that this person will get justice, and whether he'll ever be found? I mean, where is he?
Person should have chosen to create a life for himself by murdering another human being. It's just an act of pure violence, an act of insanity. Well, that's from the standpoint of a rational person. It's not the world of a loner who has no recognition, and for whom that one act of violence is a transcendent moment in his existence. At the heart of James Earl Ray is just the desire to say, somebody, look at me.
He must be ecstatic because he knows that he has done something that's sent out these shockwaves. Back in America, people are talking about him. At the same time, it must have been terrifying because he recognized that they were on to him. He knew his time was short in Canada, that he had to get out of there as quickly as possible.
Not only did he get a passport out of Canada, but he bought an airplane ticket and flew to London, then down to Portugal. He was looking to be a mercenary in Africa, and he had heard that you could make contacts in Portugal.
He tries to get a ship that's going down to Rhodesia, but he misses it by 2 days. So he's got enough money to go back to London, where he sits for the next month, and he starts to run out of money. He robs a jewelry store at one point to keep going. Finally, on June 8th, Ray goes to Heathrow. He's trying to get over to White Africa, so he's traveling under an alias, Ramon Sneed, and that happens to be on the watch list.
The Royal Canadian Mounted Police went through one by one every passport that had been issued following the assassination until they made a match on the bartending school photograph and a passport photograph out of Canada.
So Ray goes to the desk, and this agent, he looks down at a little list that had been prepared for him and saw the name, Raymond Sneed. This is one of the people that are supposed to be detained.
And it didn't take long to figure out that this is the person everybody in the world's been looking for.
The Justice Department has announced that James Earl Ray, the accused assassin of Dr. Martin Luther King, has been arrested in London, England. According to FBI,
he's flown from England to Memphis in the dead of night on an Air Force jet with FBI agents surrounding him.
He was wearing a belted straight jacket, leg shackles. Nobody knew who he was, whether he was part of an international conspiracy, whether he was leading a vast revolutionary army. He was a mystery man.
I think that Ray felt, now I'm a big man. I'm no longer a loser. I did something. I did something big. I made the FBI's top 10. I gave them a good long chase. And I come back to Memphis. Yeah, I come back in a straitjacket. But you know, forevermore, I'm somebody.
And so we have these theories of the case that, you know, as a loser, this was going to be his way to redeem himself and to get publicity, and that, you know, this would be his final mark in the world. And they go through, other different things. And I have to say that I feel they're looking at it through the perspective of, why would I, if I were to have done it, why would I have done it? Well, I might have done it because I wanted fame. But they don't really have they can't place themselves in the position of, you know, dirt poor white from Appalachia who has been in trouble his whole life, has had no family upbringing of any sort, who has been in trouble. He's in prison. He breaks out of prison. He lives in a world that is the here and now. I'm not planning about what I'm going to do this weekend. I want to figure out where I'm going to get a can of pinto beans to eat today. That is his world. And so he is a guy who I would look at as prime if I was putting together an assassination, a guy who I can get him to do what I want simply by meeting his needs of the moment. If I can get him a plane ticket, if I can get him on a boat to Rhodesia, I just have to meet his needs, and he's going to go along with what I'm doing. And it may be, he may have even thought a little broader than that and said, look, these guys are going to pay me X number of dollars to kill King, to assassinate him. I can leave that money to my brothers or something along those lines. But this is a much bigger conspiracy than one lone nut. And I think it's imperative that we think about it in those terms. Okay, Lauren, we can open up.
Okay. So who has any questions or comments? You can raise your hand or put something in the chat and we'll get to you. I just find this, I've seen this course before, and you always bring new material, and I'm always stunned by parts of it. That, for instance, the guy that was narrating that said, James Earl Ray was watching the news and he was eating this up. And I'm thinking, how do you know that? You weren't in the room with him. That seems like a jump. But that's me. Howard, if you could unmute yourself.
You could. Yes, and I'll put on the video.
There we go.
Okay. It isn't just one sole person, just like it wasn't one sole person for John F. Kennedy assassination, or Robert, in fact. But I don't think in our lifetime we will ever know the full details of that, of who was involved. And there's, of course, speculation and things, but I think those, either the people who know are dead, so they can't tell, or all the evidence and all the files are burned or buried deep and then won't show up for another 100 years or something like that may not make a difference, but it will still make a difference even if it comes out 100 years from now, because if our government or anybody in our government was involved in any of that stuff, it will just further feed the current speculation about the value of our government and government agencies. So whenever it comes out, it will be good, but it has repercussions.
Yeah, and I would say that again, if it was orchestrated professionally, it'll never come out. if you take people who are, skilled, trained in how to perpetrate these things and not get caught, it will be buried. But again, I have to look at the circumstantial evidence that's around.
Oh, sure.
When Martin Luther King is gathering as much steam as he has and power that he has, even though there is fractured within the the civil rights movement. And, you know, he's not as powerful as he was before. Remember that the two guys who were the greatest threat was Malcolm X and Martin Luther King. Malcolm X had already been killed. And by the way, the people who were convicted of his murder,
right,
has been overturned. And now they've been set free. One guy is still convicted. But again, Martin Luther King, you know, these two guys had to be killed.
There were quite a few murders that happened in a short amount of time as well.
Right. Lucretia.
Question about how he got from Memphis to Canada, and what kind of time frame are we talking about?
Oh, it's within days. I mean, he goes back to Atlanta, and he dumps his car over at the old Capital City Homes. And then he goes to his boarding house, where the place where he had been renting a room in Atlanta, which was over in Midtown. And he picks up laundry. He had dropped off laundry before he went to Memphis to kill King. And now he comes back to Atlanta and he picks up his laundry, and he rather quickly gets on a flight and goes to Canada, and then from Canada to Heathrow. So he's on the move real fast.
Also, there was a part where they said that he had bought the 30-06, took it for a little while, then he was going to trade it back in, but he tested it. But the gun, did he end up then not returning it, because the gun that he used was also a 30-06.
No, he returned it, and that the gun that he's test firing is the second weapon.
Mind, but it's you, a model.
There are the receipts from it all, and testimony from the person who sold him the weapon from a, you know, regular retail store. So yeah, the evidence is there on him. And you see, what I'm saying is, what this is all, for me, this looks planned. This looks like purposefully creating evidence that will bring you to James Earl Ray as being the gunman. It's like if I am putting it together, I want the police to get a suspect. Because I want them to close the case, and I want them not to continue investigating, looking at all different stuff. So when I look, we're going to talk more about James Earl Ray and all the evidence around him next week. But mind you, he shoots King, then he flees from that boarding house, sees police over there, and he decides to take his weapon and the paraphernalia that he had with him, the binoculars and empty beer cans and stuff like that, that he wraps in a blanket. And he leaves it in a doorway next door to the rooming house where he was staying. So the police will have no difficulty recovering his weapon. He leaves it in a spot where they'll be able to get it. So we're going to talk more about that. So I'm just saying is that what I see here are a lot of breadcrumbs that are being left. So the police will be led right to him.
Thank you.
Aren't those similar breadcrumbs to the JFK murder?
Right.
I mean, they look, they. Right.
So it's all textbook. It's textbook.
Oh, gosh. Colonel Ferris, if you could unmute yourself.
I can do it.
There we go.
So, my friend Sal. was there any, I assume for a moment, that the investigation was conducted by the Memphis Police Department? Was any federal investigation ever conducted? And if so, was there any results of that published, like the Kennedy assassination?
Yeah, there's loads of it. And the FBI jumps into it very quickly. The number two person at FBI goes to J. Edgar Hoover and says, we've got to get on top of this right away. We don't want to have the same experience as what happened with the killing of Kennedy. So we got to show that we're on top of it. And the FBI And they do. They do a great job. One of the things that Hoover suggests is that they look for any, get a list of all escaped prisoners who are out there. Again, interesting that that idea came to his mind. And to look for, because they have some fingerprints, but they want to try to narrow it down. So Hoover says, you know, look at anybody who's escaped out of prison and let's see it, you know, let's start there. That could narrow it down. And that's how they identify as James Earl Ray. And they do that pretty quick. And then they really aggressively investigate it to track him down. And so he's apprehended rather quickly. And yeah, it's pretty well documented in several congressional hearings and that kind of thing. Yeah.
If that be the case, why did they not identify Ray earlier? Because the weapon that he left and the beer cans he left would have in all probability left his fingerprints on them.
Well, yeah, but that's what I'm saying is they did identify him very quickly. I mean, they first had the name of John Galt and some other aliases that he had used, but they, pretty promptly come up with it's James Earl Ray, which is why when he's traveling through Heathrow, the customs person, has a list of names. And one of them was the name that was on his passport at the time, which I think was Galt, is the one that he got caught with. But they know it. They know it's James Earl Ray.
Thank you.
And by the way, when they bring him back, they fly him on an Air Force plane, and they bring him in a secret way. Mind you, that they are not going to allow another murder like you had of Lee Harvey Oswald. So they bring it in on a military base to have everything locked down. So there's no one who is unauthorized. No Jack Rubies are going to be able to get in there to get to him. They do that very well. Yeah.
Howard, do you have a moment there?
Sal, something in the back in the study of this was that Martin Luther King wasn't a resident at the Lorraine Motel. Was he or wasn't he?
No, he was, yeah.
Okay, because I had heard something in the past that he wasn't, that he was just visiting at the time. And that would suggest some other possibilities.
Well, it's a hotel. So, I mean, when you say resident, it wasn't like a permanent resident.
No, I know. But he wasn't staying at the Lorraine. I heard that he was not staying at the Lorraine Hotel, that he was just visiting. He was staying at another hotel.
No. He was staying there. And well,
okay.
One of the things that happened is remember the day before the first march that takes place in Memphis, the day before he's killed. And it breaks out into a riot, presumably by people who are on the payroll of the government to bring it into violence because they wanted that so it would get discredited. Anyway, what happens is when that all breaks out, they have plans to remove Martin from the march so he doesn't get hurt in the police breaking it up. And so a car pulls up and they put Martin in there, and that takes him to the Holiday Inn, which is close by. And that was the place where he went for safety at that point. But then he goes back to the Lorraine Hotel. And he stayed at the Lorraine Hotel because it's a Black-owned property.
Yeah. Okay. Thank you.
Hi, Madeline.
Madeline.
Hey, so why would what reason did the FBI have to say, let's look at escaped prisoners?
Because what they had fingerprints. They were able to retrieve fingerprints pretty quickly. But remember, at that time, we're talking the 1960s. So the process of trying to match a fingerprint to the whole database of fingerprints was much more cumbersome than it would be today. So they started, Hoover says, you know, we got to narrow it down. And he makes the suggestion, look for escaped prisoners and, you know, get theirs and see if we got somebody there. And then, of course, you then have the prisoner files that you might want to look at. Again, trying to narrow down from the mass of the database where we may find some, you know, fertile ground.
Okay, I get it.
Okay.
But the FBI does a very competent job in their involvement in that investigation and in the retrieval of James Earl Ray. My argument, my theory, though, is that it required a broader investigation. They never traced the money. Who funded him? How did he get from here to there? Where did he get the money from? I mean, he's an escaped prisoner. You know, you're on the lam. You don't have much. I mean, this is, if you're going to, and particularly at that time, if you were going to go and get a plane ticket to Canada or to London, that wasn't a cheap proposition. So I felt they needed to get into the money and also to look for the white supremacists who they had a bounty on King's head. And, you know, who was behind that? And what was there any connection with that? That's where I think the investigation, once they had the bad guy and they had the evidence that they needed to convict him, it was case closed.
Eileen,
they didn't also look at the same time that they were searching for escaped prisoners, they didn't also look at white supremacist groups that had people with records?
Well, but they kind of narrow in on that, and they get a match very quickly. So from the fingerprint that they had retrieved, they get a match, no reason to go look for more.
By the way, the first time I prosecuted a case that involved fingerprints in the late 70s, the fingerprint still had to be sent to the FBI. And we had to fly an FBI agent to come down and testify. The Georgia crime people didn't do fingerprints. They didn't test fingerprints yet. It was still the FBI.
Sure, sure. But Madeline, you're not old enough to have gone back that far.
Yeah, I am. I am.
Eileen, do you have a question or a comment? Uh-oh, you're muted. We can't hear you.
No, our microphone's on.
Can you hear her?
No.
We
can't hear her.
Well, we're having a little technical difficulty there.
Okay.
Maybe her microphone is off.
Yeah.
She's been having a few little difficulties of recent. Well, okay. We'll see if Eileen can get herself together, but Sal, why don't you tell us what's happening next week?
Well, next week we'll get into more of the investigation and what are some of the anomalies about James Earl Ray. So we'll get more into him.
Okay. Yeah. Eileen, were you able to get yourself going yet? I don't think so.
No.
Okay.
Okay. Well, anybody want to hear my poem?
Please.
Yes, please.
Okay. All right. Title of it is 1968, April Fool. At 6:01 p.m., a 30-06 pierced Dr. King's cheek, shattering his jaw, severing his spine, necktie ripped off. He dropped, 7.05 p.m., dead. I remember when they told me Dr. King has been killed. I remember falling on my knees, falling out, crying. I can remember I was in the den, all of us crying. O King of Kings, it is just as you said, like our dear captain, you've fallen cold and dead on the deck of the Lorraine Motel, Memphis, Tennessee, your final farewell. O King of Kings, so gracious and fair, to the Mason Temple Kingdom, we watched you declare a royal proclamation from your mountaintop throne that we'd get to the promised land, but we'd get there alone. O King of Kings, we rise, dying to overthrow the divine right, your noble court, loyal, carrying on the fight. For His Majesty has moved on, His peaceful legacy slain, but little do they know that we, the people, will reign. Dr. King said, a riot is the language of the unheard. And so America screamed for him. Windows smashed, buildings burned, the National Guard summoned, 43 people dead, 200 cities destroyed, 3,500 survivors injured, 27,000 civilians arrested, 58,000 soldiers deployed. A bill signed, the final Civil Rights Act, a new law, a victory, born from violence, all for fair housing.
Wow. Well, everyone can unmute and give Sal a
thank you, Sal. It's always
Sal.
Thank you,
Sal.
Thanks, Sal.
Thank you. We'll see you guys next week.